Hi everyone, Aryan here at GameDevBox. Today I will be showcasing a paid asset and helping you decide if it's worth buying. This asset is perfect for developers who want to focus on gameplay and need ready-made terrain and level design. It's a runtime procedural world asset called MicroVault. MicroVault works in both editor mode and at runtime, allowing you to generate both prepared levels and an infinite number of random levels. All you need to do is add your characters and game objects onto the prepared terrain. The asset includes a terrain generator complete with vegetation, grass, stones, trees, water, and even basic buildings in various styles. It supports both the built-in and URP rendering pipelines. After installing the package, a startup window will appear. If you are using URP, click to convert the materials and shaders. You will also find links to the developer's Discord server and the documentation. At the bottom of the window, there are various demo scenes to explore. You can open the basic demo from here, or navigate to MicroVault demo folder and open the basic scene. When you select the MicroVault game object, you will find the MicroVault component. This is the core of the terrain builder responsible for holding the spawners. Click the build button and the world will start generating. In the editor, it takes about 2 to 4 seconds to build a micro-sized level and 5 to 6 seconds for larger levels. Runtime building takes a bit longer to prevent FPS drops, generally around 6 to 10 seconds for a typical level. One of the best features is the ability to generate maps both in the editor and at a runtime. It reminds me of Stranded Deep with its runtime procedural world generation. You can even change the seed, click build, and instantly get a new world. You can also go to tools and select build or press F5 to generate the terrain. Within the MicroVault child, the terrain game object holds all the generated data. So if you don't need it, you can simply delete the game object to remove everything. If you want the default setup for MicroVault, go to Tools, Create and select MicroVault. Also, you can set up a separate scene by clicking here. The system will create a new scene with a MicroVault object, a random seed and a set of spawners. You can build the terrain right away, but to add vegetation and rocks, you will need to add some spawner. Head to the MicroVault prefabs folder, drag and drop the rocks prefab into the MicroVault object. Then go to MicroVault prefabs biomes and drag the biome template prefab inside the MicroVault object. And just like that, we have our first simple MicroVault scene. To enhance the world, it's better to add post-processing effects. You can bake lighting or adjust ambient occlusion settings and global effects to change the look and feel. If you're using the built-in pipeline, it's recommend to use forward rendering. For URP, deferred rendering gives better results. And in both cases, linear color space is preferred. Another key feature of this asset is its flexibility with your own prefabs, models, textures, and shaders. You can place your own buildings, NPCs, or other objects into the environment. MicroVault can also create paths and roads between specific areas defined by cell types. It utilizes Unity's built-in terrain system, giving you more control over the terrain and making it familiar to work with. You can manually edit the terrain after it's generated. However, if you rebuild the landscape using MicroVault, any manual changes will be lost. As stated in the documentation, MicroVault isn't designed for mobile platforms and is aimed to PC devices with mid-range to high-end graphics cards. However, with optimizations such as using lower resolution textures and a smaller map, it may be possible to achieve playable performance at least around 30 FPS on mobile devices. MicroBold is capable of creating large maps, although the developer recommends sticking to small to medium sized maps. You can add custom elements like buildings to the maps as well. For example, in the Outpost demo, a custom object is placed at the center of the generated map. This is achieved using a feature called Cell Spawner, which we will cover in more detail later. Now let's go through how it works. MicroBold itself doesn't create anything directly. Instead, it links to components called spawners, which handle world creation. When you press the build button in the MicroBold component, it searches for spawners within its child objects. It then activates each spawner in a specific order, but only processes those that are active and enabled. This setup allows you to toggle spawners on or off by activating or deactivating the spawner holder objects. You can group multiple spawners in one game object, making it easy to enable or disable them together. Certain spawners are required, like map spawner and train spawner, while others like cell spawner or road spawner or others are optional. Some spawners such as train spawner and map spawner are single use. You can only have one active instance at a time. However, if multiple instances are added, MicroBold will randomly select one. So for example, here we have a different kind of train spawners. Each of them has different settings to achieve different terrain. If I want only forest, I can disable others. Also, we can add more to this list and make our own. Other spawners like cell spawner can have multiple instances. If you have several cell spawners in the MicroBold, they will all be called during world generation. MicroBold generate everything within a child object called train, which contains all train materials and objects created by MicroBold. Nothing is generated outside of this object. MicroBold uses a foliage shader that supports GPU instancing. If you decide to use a custom shader, make sure it also supports GPU instancing. The built-in foliage shader also includes features like crossfading and more. Two methods, bunching and repeating, are available for creating multiple instances of a prefab. Bunching places a cluster of instances of a prefab within a defined radius, ideal for smaller objects like bushes, flowers, stones, mushrooms, and grass. Repeating distributes instances evenly across a cell, suitable for larger objects like rocks, trees, and big bushes, or for simulating the spread of particular plant species across the landscape. Repeating and bunching work independently of each other and can be used simultaneously. Let's take a look at the infinite world demo scene, a great starting point for building an infinite world. With a simple infinite world gate manager, you can generate the MicroBold prefab. Within this prefab, there are two gates. Each gate adds a new world to the scene. So when you find a pass through a gate, another world loads. Garden maze, this scene showcases a labyrinth style maze mixed with vegetation, giving a medieval castle vibe. Old industrial, here you will see old industrial buildings set in a natural landscape. Antique island, this scene features a garden island with antique archers and columns. Dungeon, a maze with a dungeon-like atmosphere, perfect for an adventurous feel. Cell modifiers, this demo shows how to manually adjust specific train cells. Let's explore some key components of MicroBold. seed. The seed creates a unique world layout with the same seed always generating the same train. Locked, after the train is built, the locked flag can protect it from accidental rebuilding. Custom cells, by default, the system generates cells using an internal algorithm. However, you can manually assign specific types to individual cells. Forbidden tags, certain spawners and prefab have tags that can be disabled using the forbidden tags list, so they won't be included in train generation. Now let's look at the map spawner component. Map size defines the map's width and height measured in cells with values ranging from 2 to 100. Cell size, desitting determines the size of each cell. Border padding specifies the thickness of the map's border, measured in cells with values from 1 to 3. Geometry determines the shape of cells. Microworld supports hexagonal and square shapes. Hex is ideal for natural terrains, while a square works well for urban layouts like cities or factories. Cell type frequency controls the size of train island, where higher frequency means smaller island. Cell type uniformity ensures more uniform distribution of cell types, avoiding excessive mixing. If set to false, cell types will mix more freely. Predefined cell types. Here you can define specific cell types, including the border cell type for the outer edge. This type creates a collider around the train, keeping players within the level boundaries by preventing jumps over it. The train spawner component is designed to create height maps and trains with a range of customizable settings. Let's explore some of the main options. Chance sets the probability of selecting this spawner among all train spawners in Microworld. Train and water prefab defines the train and water prefabs used to generate each new of them. Landscape settings options include slope steepness, flat chance, center elevation, and smoothing to shape the train. Main noise controls larger scale noise for defining landscape heights. Micro noise adds extra height variation for surface detail. Water covering determines how much of the train area is covered by water. Border elevation sets the height offset of border cells relative to inside cells. This can be positive or negative and helps create a visual boundary on the train. Border features offers additional flags for fine-tuning border appearance. Valley and river generates a long valley, river, or ridge across the train. There is a surface spawner component that defines the material, color, and texture blending for the train surface. The grass spawner component spawns grass across the train, with grass prefabs forming island-like clusters similar to cell type island. The road spawner builds the roads or paths between specified cell types connecting various areas. The cell spawner creates objects within each cell, such as vegetation, trees, grass, and stones. It's a core spawner for natural elements. Distance from center controls the distance range from the cell center to each spawned objects, normalized by cell radius 0 to 1. A slope and wall height. The wall height means each cell has height differences with adjacent cells, creating walls. A negative height makes a cliff down, a positive height makes a cliff up. Density sets the number of objects per surface area. Prefab points to the prefab to spawn, which can be a texture or game object. Each prefab has its own settings like render type, game object, GP instance, and others, spawning chance, repeat patterns, and clustering options. Features for each prefab can change how the prefab should work. For example, rotate Y for random Y-axis rotation. and leave to water level, which raises instances to the water surface. Ideal for floating foliage. Buildings spawner. The buildings spawner is used for creating individual buildings or maze-like structures, often in rune cells. It works with the room spawner to define buildings details, including wall height, window number, balconies, extra passages, and roof styles. All settings are covered in the documentation. Cell modifier. The cell modifier allows you to manually adjust the type and height of the cells in specific areas of the train. This assist offers a vast range of settings, making it the best solution for runtime world generation. I can't cover all of it in just a video, so that's enough for today. The assist is amazing. I have used similar assist, but this one is more production ready with detailed documents and covers a lot of things. As this is an assist review video, here are my thoughts. Don't try building your procedural world from scratch. The price of this asset is absolutely worth it, especially for solo developers and even companies. Making everything yourself isn't realistic when working alone, but with this asset you will have all the tools and options to create a world that's both fun and engaging. It's a valuable investment for what it offers. I highly recommend it if you want to generate your world and spend time creating the gameplay. For more tips, tutorials, and updates on game development, don't forget to subscribe. Thanks for watching.